So these three nuns, you know, die simultaneously in some nun-related three nun die accident. And they're up in heaven, and St. Peter's, you know, I mean, they're getting a pass. They're getting in. But he's like, you know what? I kind of should, you know, put him through the ring or somewhat. So he starts asking questions. Have you ever stolen? And they're all like, no, no, no. You know, have you ever, like, cheated on your taxes? No, no, no. And then he's like, well, you all took a vow of celibacy. Have any of you ever been physical with a man? And they all start looking down, and one of them starts, like, crying a little bit. And he's like, well, you know, just confess, and we'll move on. So the first one says, when I was young, I was, you know, still in high school, long before I went down the road to becoming a nun, I once touched a man's penis. And she was all red and embarrassed. And he said, that's okay. We're over there, and there's like a bird bath of like holy water type thing. Goes, go over, you know, rinse your hands off, say five Our Fathers and ten whatever else they say, Hail Marys. Is that a Hail Mary? That's a football thing for me. But anyways, so she goes over, washes out her hands, and he, you know, opens the gate, and she goes in. The second one, he goes, have you ever been physical with a man? And just before she could speak, the third one pushes her out of the way, runs to the bird bath, dunks in her head, gargles, and spits it out. And St. Peter's like, what's with that? She says, if you think I was going to rinse out my mouth after she put her twan in there, you had another thing coming.
Carnival personnel was recorded in the Dank Moldy basement.
Joe and Jacques. It's Carnival Personnel. Joe and Jacques. To their wives, this show is their personal hell. Well, the show sounds the same every single week. Cats are great, Trump is lame, and Joe barely speaks. Who you think still listening?
Who you think still listening?
Besides Jim and Biff,
yeah. And don't forget Richard.
Here's a random review. No one cares about you two, Joe and Jacques.
Joe and Jacques, Joe and Jacques, Joe and Jacques.
Hello, welcome to Carnival Personnel. I'm Jacques.
I'm Joe.
And that will always be one of my favorite things on this play. That makes the whole drive here and home worth it. So thank you for that.
Oh, you're welcome. It's been a while.
So before we start, usually I do, we plug the social media. And I'll do that. You can follow us on Facebook at Carnival Podcast. You can follow the show on Twitter at Carnival Podcast, or Joe at the OptiGrabber.
OptiGrabber.
And me at the Jacques Four. And now on Instagram, why? Because no one follows on that. But for the Mass Patriots team, like, I have to oversee like the social media that gets posted.
You're the social media liaison?
No, but I have to make sure it's like, well, it took a lot of pictures at the game, and there's news and stuff like that that we're supposed to, like, you know, put out there. And I have to make sure that it's getting put out there in like timely fashion. Which is not. So I signed up.
Friggin' millennials.
Seriously. Well, so
First, let's plug it. What is it?
I think it's Carnival Podcast. Like, I had to sign up under my name and in the email, but I had to pick a name. So I'm like, I'll just – because I'm never going to use it. I just have to go on and see, you know, what the other teams have done. And I don't understand it at all. I mean, literally.
Wait a minute. What's the handle for the Mass Pirates Instagram page?
The Mass Pirates is just at Mass Pirates.
Oh, okay. You were plugging that.
No. I don't care if I'm plugging that, but that's just – yeah. So I have no idea how Instagram works. I just had to sign up the other day.
Yeah, it just, like, says mass.pirates.
I'm not on Twitter. I'm a little on Twitter, but I'm never on Facebook. But now I got a third thing.
Good.
That no one can follow us on.
Okay.
But it is. It's Carnival Podcast.
We have a Carnival. I got to check this out. I got to follow our show on.
You do.
I don't have any pictures to post.
So it's funny because we're in a legal situation with the team. The team is supposed to stream their games live on YouTube.
Oh.
But they got a deal from NESN that they'll show the games on NESN. We've got a lot more eyeballs. It's like, literally, it's like in between Red Sox and the Bruins playoffs, there's our game on Tuesday and Wednesday this past week.
Okay.
A lot of feedback. But NESN won't air it unless they get at first. Like, that's the deal. We'll give you free airtime. We will show the game for free. It's a two-hour block. They get half the commercial space, which turns out to 7 minutes, 7.5 minutes an hour, and the team gets 7.5 minutes an hour. In exchange, we get the 5.5 eyeballs in the New England area through the cable sports station. Mm-hmm. So it's free, except the league fined the team $10,000 for not streaming it live on YouTube. And so I was talking to, the assistant game day director, really great kid.
Like, should you be talking about this?
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Because I'll tell you why. So it's so the kid's name is AJ, great kid, goes to Dean College. He, played college football, left college, went to play pro arena for like 3 or 4 years, and then went back and is getting his degree. So now he's coaching at Dean College, and we call him the king of the interns because he shows up at like the games with like 10 interns that he drives in from Dean with their great, great kid.
He's a cat wrangler.
But yes, but I was explaining, it's like, oh, well, I don't know why no one has suggested going to YouTube and geo-blocking the New England region. It will still stream everywhere, except it just won't stream here. And yeah, there's one other team in the New England area, so if the team from Portland, Maine comes down, the Maine Mammoth, their games – so you'll have to work out that. But they only come here once or twice a season. It's not the end of the world. You can figure something out with that. And he's like, what is geo-blocking? And I explained, and then he goes – there's a pause. And he's like, Jock, you ever think you would be explaining to a millennial how the internet works? And I'm like, you have no idea. No. Wow. Yeah. So I can talk about it because – I've been trying to – we just got a new media, kid in there. So I've been going to the other team's sites and seeing what they're doing and seeing what the league is posting. And I've been surprised that the league hasn't been posting much because the game was last – first games were last Saturday. And they had nothing like the day before the game, the day of the game, 3 or 4 days after the game. But then just yesterday, the day before, they posted – oh, our second season started. It was exciting. It was great. Here's some of the highlights. And then part of the post, they posted that. And I just handed you my phone.
Oh, my God. What is this?
So they posted the league fines. And so the Mass Pirates got it fined for
divulging information.
Yeah. Well, one of them was illegal player compensation, which they either paid somebody one player too much money, uh-huh, or they went over the salary cap. And that cost them $14,700. Failure to provide live YouTube feed, $10,000. And then failure to provide vid swap uploads in a timely manner, which is, part of that, another, $200. And then two uniform violations of $50 each. But their first game, $25,000 worth of fines.
Wow.
Which is more than what it costs to rent the DECU center for the day. So, yes, I can
mention. Is there a payment plan involved with something like that? I mean, wow.
Yeah. And
there a GoFundMe page now for the Mass Pirates?
Yes. Don't joke, because if you suggest that, I think the guy in the office
would fuck it up too anyway.
Oh, maybe.
We owe GoFundMe $30,000. How?
Oh, so. To reiterate, there's another way to not follow us on social media.
You know what? Speaking of that, I think we're geo-blocked on Apple iTunes because nobody's listening. I got to check our settings.
That microphone's not even plugged
in. Oh, my God. Wait a minute. This isn't even a basement.
And we keep saying, like, when Kramer got Phil Donahue's old set.
Oh, Merv Griffin.
Merv Griffin said. and he had the famous bird or animal guy come to his apartment.
Right. Who was that? Jack Hanna or whatever his name was? Yeah, that's great.
That was great. So quickly, because, well, first of all, as much as we make fun of ourselves and the show and the lack of listeners, we are ahead of the curve, and we were way ahead of the curve on the Qatar thing. Like, literally, when the Qatar blockade started right away, I'm like, hey, this is what's going on behind the scenes from having lived there, having friends there now, having friends in the military. And then it was 4 or 5 months later when the news broke, and it was exactly like what we had said.
You're a regular Qatar hero. So shut up. Go on.
Well done, sir. You're going to Punderdrome, aren't you?
I wish.
You'll be competing.
I got to figure that one out.
Well, this time, it was a couple months ago, you started talking about the icon in the classic arcade gaming world, Billy Mitchell,
Yes, the man you love to hate in the movie King of Kong, A Fistful of Quarters.
And it's funny because we talked, you drove the ship on that one at length about, you know, the backstory and about the cheating scandal and all this stuff. But now, for some reason, it just cycled into the mainstream media this week. And there's, you know, out of our loyal six listeners, a few of them, you know, were even saying, hey, you were talking about this months ago. Why is it making the news now?
Well, actually, this is a continuation of that previous story. So when we last left off with Billy Mitchell and Twin Galaxies, Twin Galaxies apparently had received a lot of complaints about Billy Mitchell's submissions for the Donkey Kong records that he had. He held the record for the first million point score on a Donkey Kong machine. And the way their submissions work back then were kind of dubious. You were technically supposed to have somebody witness the player achieving the high score on an actual machine from Twin Galaxies. Billy Mitchell was so in with that crowd, and it was a very cliquish crowd in the 80s and the 90s, that he would just start submitting videotapes. Thank you. One for me, one for my homies. So he was just submitting videotapes, and then Twin Galaxies would be taking that as a valid submission. Long story short, too late. A few months ago, somebody on the internet who was also an avid video game enthusiast, an arcade enthusiast, pointed out in a detailed video of how his submission on videotape looked like he played the game not on an actual arcade machine, but on a computer emulator that would basically allow them – it would allow him to, like, hit save points. So if he got tired, he could stop, pick it up later, and it could be sewn together to look like it's all one continuous play. And then, of course, that would be illegal, quote-unquote, by the rules of Twin Galaxies, and unfair to everybody else who's actually playing on a real machine. So when we did the story, that was being called into question. Like, Twin Galaxies was since sold to another group by Walter Day, who was the guy in the referee outfit in the King of Kong movie who started Twin Galaxies. But now a younger, fresher crop of people who are not part of the old guard have taken over, and they've started to actually go through the books and say, look, there was like one gatekeeper. Like, a lot of the records were being called into question because they were just, you know, a lot of them were just not very valid looking, and they were dubious at best. I like that word, dubious. Anyway, so long story short, again, too late. This is the sort of the sentencing of Billy Mitchell. Like, Twin Galaxies has finally come to the conclusion that, yes, he cheated. He played Donkey Kong on an emulation program versus on an actual Donkey Kong machine. And there were other, probably other submissions that were called into question that were since proven invalid. So they just said, you know what? Fuck this guy. All of your titles that you've held for decades are now stripped, which are very precious to this guy. If you've seen the movie, you can see how proud he is of his records and his standing, and how he's, you know, actually kind of parlayed that into a little cottage industry of him for himself, for his hot sauce and stuff. He's kind of a little mini celebrity. You know, they took that away, and they banned him from making any future submissions ever again. So this is sort of like a, you know, if Mr. Potter ever had a comeuppance scene, like, you know, like if they ever like came back 30 years later and said, you know what, this is what happened to Mr. Potter. He went to jail and he died of syphilis. And, you know, like this is sort of what happens to Billy Mitchell after, you know, years of just deceiving the public and being just a complete douchebag. Finally getting what he deserved.
You know, and it's one of those things. So, you know, jumping way ahead, like my Netflix pick of the week, we'll touch, you know, circle back on Billy Mitchell just briefly. But right now, what's really interesting, so I started reading up on this. So Twin Galaxies was just a regular arcade in Iowa?
Oh, no, it's in New Hampshire.
No. The Twin Galaxies, Day's first place.
Oh, I see.
And it was like literally, it's somewhere in like the Northwest. It's okay. Like in a small town. I mean, I'm talking a tiny town. And it was the funny thing is when I saw a different documentary and they had the footage from Twin Galaxies, it's about the same size of the arcade that, you know, Mike Sullivan and I went to down the street from our house in Wilmington. It was one room, just like the games going around on the wall, but it wasn't like an island of games. It wasn't a lot of space. And Walter Day liked playing games himself. And so he thought, oh, this is an upcoming thing. So it's the size of this basement. It's this part of the basement where we are right here. And it's just so funny that that one little room has become the de facto center for, you know, gaming at the time. And 50 years, 40 years later, still being the de facto center of the galaxy as far as it comes to classic arcade gaming. And he's the one, like Walter Day is the real hero who started these competitions. I mean, it was really interesting. And again, you know, there's a new documentary. But so the fascinating thing about Mitchell, complete douchebag. And so I've been reading up on this, and people were asking Walter Day what he thought. And he's like, well, whatever has come to light, you know, is only part of the story. And the other part of the story is who you saw King of Kong is, it's like anything else, like we talked about. Like, you know, when Bobcat Goldthwait gets off stage, he's not Bobcat Goldthwait all the time. And same thing. He's like, they talked about like, how helpful he is and what a good person he is. And like, that's a persona. That's part of the image. It's part of, you know.
Oh, so it's like a wrestling promo kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, is that an element of him? At the same time, I was thinking about this. I was thinking, just thought I'd drive over. But he's kind of like the Lance Armstrong of the video game world, where he was this champion. And then, you know, he has his fall from grace, but he's done some good stuff along the way. For, I mean, nobody in America, I mean, literally, you know, our buddy John and my friend Dermot live for the Tour de France. I don't know anybody else who ever would watch it before Lance Armstrong or after, or if it even cycles, no pun intended, if it even makes the news here. But it was Lance Armstrong, and it was, you know, the story of him and the incredible story and the fighting the cancer and all that stuff. Arcade gaming or this classic arcade, Twin Galaxies doesn't exist without Billy Mitchell. It doesn't. It, you know, as much as people want to absolutely hate George Lucas for Jar Jar Binks, it's like the Star Wars universe was created by this guy. So without Walter Day, who was just a local business guy, and it grew because of this, and you know, a couple smart moves early on in the gaming to become the, like I said, the de facto, I'll keep all the records, you know, and because he was who was the second man on the moon? Thank you. So because
it was Buzz Aldrin, but go on.
Because he started it, you know, he got it. And again, this world was largely launched because of Walter Day and Billy Mitchell, and it's relevant today. I mean, you go to the arcade gaming convention in Connecticut every year, and this retro gaming, it has a face. So now it's interesting. It's like, you know, it's like, okay, so when the world cycling, when, the, you know, said Lance Armstrong, you're done for life, they had to know. Oh, same thing. You know, if you hated Tiger Woods and really reveled in his downfall, and your life was on the golfing side, like working in network golfing, you're cheering for your own demise. I mean, the ratings have never been what they were at the peak of you know, Tiger being Tiger. You know, and again, like with the Patriots, it's like you either love them or you love to hate them, but if they're a rating juggernaut. So that it's a funny thing. It's like, yeah, he was a real douche, and everything I've seen him in, he just has this really arrogant and holds himself. It's like, really? You're great because you had a great video game score in 1982.
Looks great on a resume.
For him, it did. But it's funny. It's a really interesting story. His fall from grace, but the banned from life thing.
It's harsh.
Yeah,
it's harsh. Yeah. Well, you know, easy come, easy go. I mean, he got drunk with power.
So I know. It's funny because I saw my sister yesterday, and she's like, so I was listening to the podcast the other day. I'm like, what?
What?
Like, literally on purpose? And she's like, yeah, I didn't even realize she was working it out of the house. And she's like, the whole Tetris
thing. Thank you, autoplay.
Yeah, exactly. But it was funny. She goes, yeah, it just happened to be an episode where we talked a lot about video games, and she's not a video. She's the one person who wanted us to talk more about politics. So we'll get done talking about Twin Galaxy and Billy Mitchell for now. Let's talk about the movie Rampage.
Based on a video
which
game.
Which I didn't know. It's funny because that show, that trivia thing, HQ, that management loves.
Right.
I implore you, maybe my Netflix Redbox pick of the week would be go to, you know, the Google machine and type in The Rock hosting HQ. She was driving the other day and he hosted it. Dude, it was 15 minutes of hilarity. I mean, he was great, but he was on it promoting Rampage and they were talking about it. And like, I had no idea it was based on a video game.
Yeah, it's an arcade game from, get this, the 80s.
What?
Yeah, you play one of three monsters and your whole purpose is to climb buildings and bust your windows open and grab people out of the windows and eat them. It basically causes much destruction or go on a rampage, if you will, as possible. And you're swatting down army helicopters and you're stepping on tanks. You are the bad guy because you're the bad monster. But it was unique in this sense that, you know, all those other, you know, up until that time, you're battling monsters. And now here you are. And it's very funny. It's very cheeky. You know, like there is a scene in the game where you can break somebody's window open and the guy's taking a bath, you know. It's very funny.
Hashtag me too.
Right. Well, you know, it was a guy, so it was okay. It's funny how video games now are becoming, you know, source material for movies. This movie's like a popcorn movie. It's not like... It's above Pixels, I think it would be above Pixels as far as storytelling goes.
Are you saying it is not Oscar bait?
It is not.
Okay.
It is not even Oscar Mayer bait.
that is. So on HQ, so The Rock was hosting it with the normal guy, Rogowski, who's a funny – I mean, even if you don't
– I've tried HQ a couple of days.
Yeah, it's fun. I mean, and even when we lose, you can still watch. Yeah. You know, he's a funny guy. If you like that sense of humor. One of the trivia questions is which of the three monsters was not on the side of the panel for the original arcade?
Oh, okay.
You know, it was a gorilla. So, like I said, the promo, it looks like a rock movie, you know, but it's interesting because, like I said, we've learned a little sign language. Steve and Flora, they do sign language with their kids, so we've had lots of talks about that. So he's communicating with the gorilla on this, and it's like the gorilla is kind of the victim of an experiment gone bad, and he's like the good guy, and it's like, and the last thing I expected, it was based on an 82 video game. It's like, wait a minute, how do you extrapolate that into this?
And after this, we're playing Rampage on emulator.
Who's been sitting on that script for the last 40 years?
I might have Rampage for the NES over there. No, maybe I don't. Anyway, but that's for the it'll.
Do you have Rampage here? And what? How? Wait, I'm sorry.
Yes.
How many versions of Rampage? You
no,
have?
I think I have it on my. I think I have it in a very legitimate way, not an illegitimate way. Nor would I ever condone downloading a game illegitimately play on your computer.
I wouldn't even think about that.
Good. Be smart, don't start.
So, was MySpace the first big social media platform? I mean, big social media platform. I know there was like college friend finder or a high school friend finder type thing.
Classmates.com.
Classmates, that's the one. Classmates.com.
I think MySpace was the first one to really kick it into gear and make it more broadcast and mainstream.
And you don't probably have Facebook without having MySpace first. I mean, that was
absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
Is that what C-SPAN is to MSNBC and everybody? Because everybody for years joked. I mean, C-SPAN was the nationwide version of cable access local, you know, selectmen, you know, committee hearings.
Yep.
No offense to our great friends and. What do they call it now?
ACMI.
Yeah, our friend Kim, you know, does it down in I almost said Bedford. That's her old Plymouth. Mm-hmm. You know, no disrespect for the fine work those people do with
community
local
media.
Community media. Thank you. And that's what C-SPAN is. Let's set up a camera and for the next 8 hours have live coverage of paint drying.
There was an exciting moment one time when somebody bumped the camera.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was crazy. Yeah. Shit, man, that went viral.
And so people like, you know, you would see Saturday Night Live skits like basically panning C-SPAN and how boring and useless this is. But now, Senate hearings, it's just this past week alone. I mean, it was everybody stop, must see TV.
You're welcome.
and it didn't even deal with the Donnie Two Scoops. It was like, you had Mark Zuckerberg, which was... It was great.
Yeah, it was pretty fascinating. In 5 hours.
Dude. Well, yeah, you know, and that's like, look, when they get back to Benghazi, there was one day where Hillary sat there for 11 straight hours of grilling. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, so the Zuckerberg thing, and we'll jump on that in a sec, but I was thinking, like, the people at C-SPAN have to be thinking, it's like you know, Tom from MySpace. It's like, you fuckers wouldn't be here. Like, MSNBC doing huge numbers. You know, Fox doing huge numbers. There's like all, like, CNN, Fox, and MSNBC, and I bet C-SPAN also covering this the other day.
You think Tom from MySpace and the guy who invented C-SPAN are in a bar watching the hearings, like both hating like Mark Zuckerberg and the national coverage of Senate hearings?
I said that to management, and she and you, when I say this, you're going to be like, oh, that's right. And I know you've heard about this. Somebody a couple years ago, like when Facebook went public, you know, I guess – made a comment like Tom from MySpace had commented on something, and somebody basically says, oh, this coming from the guy. Like, there was something where something went sideways, and Tom from MySpace said, oh, you know, I would have handled it this way. And somebody's like, says the guy who, you know, who drove MySpace into the ground. And he wrote back, you know, I sold MySpace for $560 million in 2004, and you're working a 60-hour week with the hope of getting a half day off for Christmas. And it was like,
burn!
You could hear in the text him drop the mic. But it wasn't like, oh, and she was trying to recount it. It's like, oh, you know, I sold it for X amount, and you still have a job, you know, you still go to work. And it was that, but on steroids. It was so soul-crushing. It's like, I'm going back to sleep on my mattress made of money and cover myself with an Afghan of supermodels.
Yeah, good luck with your mac and cheese and ketchup. I'm from the Loser Institute.
Yes. So...
Hody Oten Doten Day, Hody Oten Day, oh, Hody Oten Doten Day, fattening up our tapeworms.
Welcome, America. And so that's so it was interesting. So this week, you know, in the era of C-SPAN now becoming much watch TV type thing, did you watch any of the Zuckerberg stuff?
Yeah, I did see some of it. And Mark Zuckerberg is an odd looking fellow. I like the comparisons that people made instantly online about how he looked strikingly similar in resemblance to Data from Star Trek. That was pretty funny. But, you know, him trying to explain away how Facebook is a, you know, cooperative company, that they'll do anything they can to rectify the situation. He wasn't aware of all these things. Bah, 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 bah. I can't believe I was kind of siding with Lindsey Graham on something.
Don't you hate that?
I hated it because he brought up the point.
It's like you got to root for the Jets to win this game to help your playoff seeding.
And well, Lindsey Graham brings up a decent point. If I, you know, what kind of competition does Facebook have? Because it seems like they have a monopoly. If I buy a car and it doesn't, and I don't like the car, I can bring it back and go get another car from another company. What does Facebook have as far as real competition goes? And the answer is nothing. They acquire Instagram. They acquire WhatsApp. They acquire all of these startups, kind of like Google. They acquire all of these ancillary social media companies that are burgeoning and on the cutting edge of newer technology, and then just absorb them as part of their own. And yeah, it's like they're like Ma Bell of the internet. There's no... They're not providing internet access. It's not like the cable companies, which is another thing altogether, as far as, you know, monopolies go. But as far as social media goes, yeah, if you want to connect with people from, you know, so many years ago, if you just want to have, like, you know, a network of friends that you just keep in touch with and you can post your food pictures on, Facebook is the one and only place. Like, Jacques, I dare you to name it. Don't give me Friendster. Give me a second social media platform in which you can share, you know, with people you know, not strangers on the internet, like with Amsterdam strangers.
Grindr?
Grindr, yeah, okay, touche. But yeah, But we have to the whole point is this is that the US government now has to look at social media platforms that present news, real or fake, as sort of a broadcasting entity, because that's what they are. They're like NBC. They're like,
yeah,
you know, they're like a newspaper, because they post things, or people can go onto Facebook from dubious backgrounds and post news of dubious nature and purport it to be real news, whether or not it's fake. And there's no vetting of that process, and there's no governing of that process.
We're talking Fox or Facebook. I can't.
Yeah, you know. Well, eventually they'll merge and become one. But that's what's happening, is that Facebook is not – nobody's overseeing their content, and they've been allowed for years to just sort of run free in the wild, wild west of social media on the internet. And now there is no real guarantee – it's almost like there's been like correlations between this hearing with Facebook and the Senate hearing made years ago with the video game industry, and how they were, you know, putting out content that was, you know, not suitable for children, that was too violent, and how do parents know? And that led to the them self-regulating and becoming and forming the Entertainment Software Ratings Board, which is where they get the ratings for games. Here with Facebook. Facebook is basically trying to convince Congress to let them govern themselves without intervention. And I don't know if that's possible, because there is no – it's not like Facebook is going to team up with the major competitor to Facebook and then get together.
Right.
Because there is nothing. It's them. It's all or nothing for that kind of thing.
Well, there is it's like the history has shown it. It's like the movie industries, and we've talked about this. Where did the rating system come from? From the movie industries,
because right, from multiple studios.
Right, they got together and said, "Okay, there's all this pressure. Let's do something now before they do it." And the thing with Facebook, it was like right at the election, you know, it started to come out like that they were taking money from Russia, and it was great. No, we didn't. Here's an invoice, or here's a receipt in which you were paid in rubles. And again, I'd give anything to be funny enough to make that up. And that wasn't a red sign. That wasn't a signal to you that, anyways. So they've done these things. No, we had nothing to do with it. Oh, well, yeah. We could have done this. Oh, we should. For the last 8 months now, the last year plus, it's like, oh, we should have seen this. But then it's not until the whistleblower from Cambridge Analytica, you know, comes out and says, look, they knew this. They knew that we had their data. And so what was interesting, you know, focusing on the hearing itself, is it was a twofold thing. On one hand, this is the oldest Senate, like to date, like the oldest average age of it. And you had a lot of grandpas.
Sir, how does Facebook make all that money if you don't charge? We sell ads.
Like, that was a legitimate exchange.
Okay, then.
The longer exchange, it's like, you know, you always said Facebook was – I'm not going to do an accent. You're the one who can do it. But he was saying you sat here or, you know, Facebook in 2004, and you said Facebook was always be free. You were committed to that. I know you're still committed to that today. And then he very politically, you know, Zuckerberg said, well, there will always be a free version of it, which means all you Facebook people – get ready to start paying. There's going to be a fee sooner or later. But then he goes, well, and how do you survive? And that's when it was like you could see data. I'm sorry, I'm a Zuckerberg computing. Okay, he's setting a trap. So I know the simple answer is we sell ads, but what is he trying to back me into? And then when he says, you know, Senator, we sell ads. Fair enough then. You know.
Well, the thing is this, is that I forget who said it, but if something is free, then the consumer is the product.
One of the oldest sayings. If you sit down at a card game and you don't know who the sucker is, you know. But yeah, one of the things. So there was a lot of grandpa. It's a series of tubes type moments.
Oh, the pipes.
The pipes.
Yeah.
You know. It was when you were talking about you know, people getting their news source from it. It's like, yeah, Facebook. I equate a little bit to the old tagline the Daily Show had, where more people get their news
Than probably should.
It's like, but
when news breaks, we fix it.
That was the other one. And then they, the things that I liked, the highlights I liked is one of the senators just starts reading. Like he has the user agreement in front of him.
Right.
And he reads the first paragraph.
That was Lindsey Graham,
I think. It Lindsey Graham?
Yeah, and he holds up the big stack of
the phone book.
Yeah.
You know, but he reads it and he reads the first paragraph and he's like, I've been a lawyer for 30 years. I don't understand any of that. Do you think the average user on Facebook understands this? And Zuckerberg answered the question by not answering it. And he said, I don't think many of the people actually read it. It's like, okay, you're right.
Yes.
Agreed. You didn't answer the fucking question. The question was, do they understand it? Because here's a lawyer saying, I don't get any of this.
And to be fair, the reason that stack was so thick was because of the type of font was a 36 point. Because he's an old guy.
But it was still, even if...
Double-spaced.
But it was still, it's like, yeah. You know, if you printed it out, it's like dozens and dozens of pages.
Yeah, same with Apple or any sort of technology end user license agreement. Nobody reads that.
No, nobody. And so, and that was a really good point. The other point that I liked is, you know, and again, I hate to say it, but it was a great line of questioning from, you know, from a Republican bastard who said, Mr. Zuckerberg, do you mind telling us where you stayed last night? What hotel you stayed in? And Zuckerberg's like, he has a face like, again, okay, I know this is a got you question. Let me really think about it. And in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, he doesn't want to say he stayed at Trump Tower or at the Trump Hotel. That's where I'm going. You know, I'm thinking.
You're always on Trump's.
I know. But that's what I thought he was going to, you know. And then he's like, I don't feel comfortable telling you. Oh, okay. Well, did you text any friends yesterday? Probably. Because, oh, do you mind telling everybody what you were texting your friends about? And he's like, no. Like, dummy, why the fuck would I want to tell anybody that? And then he's like, but you're okay knowing where we all stay in hotels and have access to our text messages.
Right. But the twist there is that end users volunteer this information. We post stuff, not you, the royal we, post stuff on the internet to share, quote unquote, with the world, thinking, oh, you know, it's just among friends. It's not on a server forever.
Right.
But we're volunteering information to the world. And we know in the back of our mind, maybe they'll use this for like some sort of ad thing, whatever. I'm not doing anything illegal. Nothing. What are they going to find out about me?
Well, that was the thing. It's like, it's one thing if you message somebody back and forth, but there's a privacy messaging.
Well, the Facebook Messenger app, what happens is that there's an opt-in feature in which if you want Facebook Messenger to synchronize with your contacts on your phone and sort of be the one-stop shop for all texting, then you have to opt into that. And then what Facebook's Messenger does is that it mines all the data from your phone and stores it. Little did they know, it's not just on your phone. Right. They take that information and export it to Facebook. And then it's on a barge of, you know, hard drive somewhere. And that's kind of creepy.
So that was a great, those were a couple great lines of questioning. It's like, of course I don't want all this information out there. And again, like, oh, we feel really bad about like the 86 million people, but every day you find out it was more people and all this stuff. And I don't know what the answer is, but at the end of the day, there is no competition. So how do you regulate yourself if you're not, you know, but again, when you have a Republican saying, oh, there's no, this, it's a monopoly. It's like, yeah, but aren't you signing off on a monopoly after monopoly after monopoly? But it's, and you could tell. Oh, the other highlight, the great thing is a lot of it's all grandstanding, and
all dog and pony show stuff.
Right. Every one of these guys who asks the got you questions is doing it for their 15, 30 second ad.
They're not doing it physically, but they might as well be tugging on their suspenders as they're, you know, Mr. Zuckerberg. I may not,
Mr. Haney.
I'm just an unfrozen senator. I don't know anything about your internets.
But you know, it's all for ads in October and November. For all those, so one guy was going off about, you know, Mr. Zuckerberg, you know, what you've created here out of your dorm room couldn't have happened anywhere else in the world. Is there any place in the world, you know, other than America that you could have done this? And he's like, yeah, you know,
England,
and he goes, "You were supposed to just agree with me." Right. It was like that was his big
Hulk
moment.
Hogan was ready to like come out busting out,
or the Kool-Aid,
right, or like an eagle was gonna fly in,
yeah, on his
arm, and I'm proud to be an American. Yeah, so what a. But, so where does this all lead us?
No, it's just kind of funny that it's what a busy week, and then following, and that was 2 days, and then you had the Senate hearing for Pompeo, which
I don't know. Maybe we can skip that.
We can, but here's a guy who wouldn't answer two-thirds of the question because, you know, they're open investigations, or because he's at the head of the CIA now, and, you know, he's going for the other. But while he was a congressman, he was very homophobic, and he thinks that gay sex should be illegal, and he was asked if he still feels that way today. And he said – and he didn't – again, tried to not answer the question and said, look, at the CIA, there's married gay couples, and I treat everybody the same, but do you still feel the same way? It's hard to say, you know, I hate these fucking fangins. But I treat them great at work, you know. It's like, no, you can't really. And the highlights of that, if he was asked flat out, is as Secretary of State, if he would resign if Mueller got fired. And he said, no, of course not. The job is more important for Secretary of State than to one issue like that. He admitted that he still is completely homophobic. And yeah, like honestly, he's like, I still feel the way I did. I'm not talking anymore about it. And there was a couple other, you have said these awful things in the past. You feel this way now. I'm here to talk about the job I can do. And he flat out said, you know, it's not about what he thinks. It's about what the president thinks. So he, he literally in front of the world got down on his knees. Yes, sir, may I have another? Mm-hmm. Said he wouldn't quit under anything. Whatever Trump says goes. And I still hate gays.
Right. Which is, by the way, not a great, you know, fallback. It's like, look, maybe I hate the gays, but it's not about me. It's about what our great president thinks. It's like, wait, this guy doesn't like people.
but again, you know, my whole point was like the guys who created C-SPAN, you know, of like the Watching PageRide Network, and now it's the biggest thing. I was like, these hearings, it's like.
And by the way, did you watch it on C-SPAN?
No. I don't know if I can find C-SPAN.
You know how many C-SPANs there are?
I think three. I think there are, yeah. You know, like one for each, like, you know, the house. There's one.
Oh,
are they different channels? Are they?
The
original programming lacks.
Right. Anyways.
So, you know, we'll just finish off because we won't go too. Did any thoughts on the Comey book coming out? Or that's now out and the reaction to it?
Well, there's excerpts out. I don't think the book has been released.
The book's out now.
I think the book is out now.
Yeah, it came out the other day. All the experts came out. Excerpts came out.
Oh, okay.
And he's doing all the TV rounds.
Right. And after when this posts, the interview with George Stephanopoulos will have aired. We haven't seen it yet because we're in the past. But I don't know. I think it's a way to sell books. It's a way to get ratings. It's a way to get the Sunday night, you know, anti-Trump ratings.
Right.
Yep. I don't know how that's going to make a dent. I don't know if it's – again, it's just more dog and pony show stuff.
I'm done. I'm not like every time he would come on or I would see it, it's like, yeah. Because you're selling books that – you know, so you got to start with the P-tape stuff and talk about that at length. At the end of the day, he's still president because of your actions. And that's it. And I won't overlook that.
Right, and listen,
8 days beforehand. Like,
I know.
Honestly,
listen, you don't have to school me on what the fucking past was.
I'll school you.
Yeah, but no, honestly, yes. James Comey was the villain, and then he was a hero, and then now. We don't know what to think. All I know is that there are many, many reasons why Trump got elected. It was a perfect storm of shit. It was Facebook. It was Russians. It was Comey.
But 8 days before reopening the email thing was crucial. It was huge.
Right.
People who were on the fence
bad
were now
time.
Like, oh. But anyway.
But how do you quantify that? But yeah, I agree. It was not a good thing. Nor do I think that if Comey didn't do what he did, that we'd be talking about President Clinton right now. Because that's just fucking stupid. honest. It is. I mean, come on.
But I can't, like, I'm not like, oh, he's great and I hope this book does well. No. It's like it's another embarrassment for him, but I'm not going down that rabbit hole. And the last two things that, you know, of the awful coming up, it's like, well, now that right, exactly. Now that Bolton's in there, the defections, either he's firing everybody or people are quitting, and we haven't even talked about this. As we're doing this, we're what, 15 hours out from bombing of Syria, which, yeah, exactly. It's, and that's dog and pony show. Like everybody says, militarily, like the last year's bombing, it did nothing. It
right, like, and they're thinking that they probably have just bombed empty warehouses now.
And here's my question to anybody who's like, that's leadership. Look at him go. And yeah, they're not going to take chemical attacks. My first question is, okay, this is awful. Instead of bombing the people who use chemical things on these poor civilians, can we take in some refugees? Are we opening our borders? Are we going to – like if you want to do something, be humanitarian and get, you know, refugee relief. Let those people come here. Secondly, Joe, and answer this question, chemical weapons are absolutely awful. What's the difference between – just bombing, you know, civilians indiscriminately anyways? Is it more humane to have like a limb blown off with like a landmine or like mortar attack? I mean, why is the chemical weapon the line in the sand? Oh, sure, you can torture and kill and blow up your own people. You just can't do it with bleach.
Right. I don't know. It's a crazy situation, but I do like that there's a President Trump tweet or Donald Trump tweet from 2013.
Yes, go ahead.
That kind of contradicts what his current actions are. From Donald Trump, August 30th, 2013.
The president must get congressional approval before attacking Syria. Big mistake if he does not.
And this is the second time he's done the same thing. He's attacked Syria twice without congressional approval.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. I thought you were going to read the tweet about what he said when basically Obama said, we're going to bomb this place. Get your fucking civilians out of there. You know, this is where you make these weapons. We're going to bomb the place you make the weapons. We're letting you know we don't want to kill anybody. We just want to keep you guys from making these weapons. And Trump several times tweeted out how asinine and stupid it is to tell people that you were going to do this. And for the last 4 or 5 days beforehand, we're coming, we got the smart bombs, they're the smartest bombs, we got the newest, smartest bomb. I mean, he told them that they were going to do this. And again, it's one thing to how would somebody react if Obama had this thing with Stormy Davis or Daniels? You know, it'd be like drawing comparisons to a hypothetical. This is the exact same thing. In the exact same situation, this is what he said.
This is apples to apples.
100%.
A president talking about Syria and him. Yeah, right. It's
It's not even, oh, well, he was saying if you use weapons against another country without congressional thing, the same exact country. You know,
1-to-1.
And then he turns around and said, and unfortunately, my dad the other day, you know, we were kind of talking about this and he was saying, well, if Obama had taken care of this, he wouldn't have to now. Right. Exactly. It's like, so everything.
He's saying exactly because I rolled my eyes.
Right. Right. It's like everything. And what I love is like yesterday, the day before, some Republican poll came out. Where is it? Rasmussen poll. Like, I'm polling higher now than the cheating like Obama ever did at the same point. I'm like, it's not like Obama came out yesterday and said, oh, I wouldn't have handled things X, Y, and Z. He's not out there saying anything about them. But for no reason, he just feels a need to shit on the black guy as much as he can.
Yep. And then when he's not doing that, he shits on the woman that he beat in an election.
Oh, no, he's still running against her.
Oh, right.
Yeah, no, we're still waiting for all the votes to be counted, apparently.
Right. I mean, right. There will be no rest until apparently she's either in jail or dead.
But at least it looks like Pruitt could be out at the EPA soon because the scandals are catching up to him. Mm-hmm. So at least they appointed his successor yesterday, whose last job is the number one lobbyist for the coal industry. So, you know, well, Pruitt's going to be out. Don't worry. At least we're still going to get to, have our way with the environment. And by have our way, I mean ruin the environment
nature
for our children.
Nature is a whore. We can have some more. Name the song.
That is, what is that? Is that on In Utero? That is
That's Nirvana.
No, but I'm trying to think of the name of the song because I'm never good
in
with
Bloom.
In Bloom. In Bloom. Yeah, no, so In Bloom is on
Nevermind.
Yeah. I think it was track 7 on the CD.
Yes, it was.
Wow, that's sad that I know.
No. No. It's good that you know that.
Or for the millennials out there, it was the second track on the B side. Yeah, if you had to flip it over. Because I had to do the math of like how many songs were on the first side. Okay, flip it. Yeah, this was the second song if you had it on a record. You're welcome!
Bam, bam, go-go-go-go-go-go-go, bam, bam, go-go-go-go-go-go, bam, bam. Okay, whatever.
You know who loves Nirvana is the guitarist for the Foo Fighters. He's a big fan.
Wow, yeah.
Big fan.
Whatever happened to him?
Yeah, probably drunk in a gutter somewhere.
Yeah, you know.
What time is it?
Time for Defunct Sponsor of the Week.
I'm hoping it's Chesterfield cigarettes.
Oh. Might as well be Nirvana.
Ha presents world premiere programs, new TV comedy you can't see anywhere else, like Clash, a challenging new world premiere game show.
How are you?
Fine.
Judges? That's correct, Bill. You won the game.
And the talent pool with world premiere performers.
I may be a product of Chicago public school system, but I can read.
So sit back on your world premiere couch and watch new TV comedy Friday and Sunday night starting at 9 on Ha, the new world premiere TV comedy network.
Okay, so now we're getting to Joe's favorite part of the program, sports.
Woohoo!
So last week I talked about the Vegas Knights are now my second favorite hockey team. It's always been the Bruins, and then 20 years in L.A., it's the Kings. But the Vegas Knights are just awesome. Nothing to do with hockey. It's all the game day ops presentation, and we talked about the retiring the number 58 last week. So they hosted, in their first season, they're hosting a round one playoff series against the L.A. Kings. And I could not suggest more going to YouTube and watching these six-minute opening ceremonies. They had a full-on, like, theater-level presentation on the ice and in part of the stadium. And I'm going to mess it up. It's like with that dinner theater thing where it's jousting and all that stuff. What's that called? Like,
oh, like medieval times?
Yeah, they have this full-on medieval times because their logo is a knight. So it's this knight comes out with a big shield and fights, you know, these L.A., like the hordes from L.A. and stuff like that. You got to check it out. I literally, even if you don't like hockey, their pregame presentation is epic. And I'm like, these guys get it. It's like they have taken it to the next level. And all my friends around the sports landscape, I've sent the clip out. And even the guy's name is Johnny, who runs the Knights. I'm like, dude, you guys just dropped the mic and walked off stage.
You run a team called the Massachusetts Pirates.
That's my
job. Get on it!
And my job is to, well, if we could take,
Johnny Depp, if you're listening,
if we could take the $25,000 in fines that we had in the first week and apply it to game day presentation.
By the way, Jacques, you're not getting paid this season. Yeah. I don't want to get into the details of why, but.
Even if you're not a hockey person, just, you know, Google, go to YouTube what the Knights did. As we're speaking, the Bruins are getting ready for game 2 of round one. A great, great, well, it wasn't a great game. You know, it's a 5-1 blowout, but it was 1-1 at the end of the first. But
I'm actually surprised, maybe it's because you've been living in the area for some time, but I'm surprised to hear you actually talk more about the Bruins because you are a Bruins fan for, you know, virtually a lifelong Bruins fan, but there were some seasons there where you were kind of, you know, nonverbal about them.
Those were the years like around the time when Bork was like, because Ray Bork got screwed so hard, and it was hard to.
But
like,
even like recently, like, you know, even between their last Stanley Cup win and now, like, I mean, how were you that much of a Bruins watcher?
No, I'll admit it. It's like I rather go to games and watch them. And I kind of made a decision like a few years ago. It's like my obsession with the Patriots is pretty much enough, and that I used to be like that with the Patriots and then be like that with the Bruins, but I can't be like that year round. It's like after the last Patriot game is played, whenever that happens to be, until about a month before the Stanley Cup. But I'll watch periodically. You know what I mean? It's like if Biff is tweeting or texting me, it's like, did you see this? And about once a week or every couple of weeks, I'll have like the NHL Tonight on the background. I love Marchand. I love this team. This team is a great mix of teams. So I followed this more this year than the past couple years. But they also didn't make the playoffs 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
3 years. 1 year they had.
Oh, Mr. Fairweather Bruins fan over there.
No, I know. No, it's because it wasn't. I'm not getting hyped up about.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Mid-season hockey.
Exactly. Yeah.
And the Bruins had two streaks this year where they went like one loss in 20 games. And it was great, but it was in the middle of Patriots season. So we mentioned it a little. Yep. But yeah, I mean, when 2 years in a row they had like the best record in team history. And not make the playoffs. Like, not the best record ever, but the best record they had without making. They missed the playoffs 2 years in a row by like 1 point. Both years, like, losing their last two games. So it's like, yeah, I wasn't getting hyped up on that. But no, so that is going on. And of course, you know, tonight, well, no, actually, because
Saturday,
by the time this post, you can go this past week. Nesson showed the Mass Pirates game, and they are playing tonight, which is Saturday. But by the time you hear this, jump right on over to YouTube and you can watch the Mass Pirates play the Jacksonville Sharks,
There's a $10,000 paywall to watch it on YouTube, apparently.
So we're in the meeting, and somebody's talking about, like at the Pirates meeting, was talking about, well, we can't lose the Nesson deal. That's free television. And the owner goes, it was free.
Yeah.
Now it's $10,000. and we're all like, well, at least he's laughing about it. Like, you know, but he knew that fine was coming. I don't think anybody knew the $14,000 fine for the salary cap violation. Mm-hmm. I don't think the salary cap's 14 grand for the team. I don't. I think the average pay is probably $500 a game per player for the 20 guys on the roster. But
you better check that rule book to see if an elephant can't play. There's a lot of stuff in there that you're not.
See, so if Joe came to the game and sat next to me at the broadcast booth, there's a couple new rules. Each arena league has slightly different rules, and they're trying to standardize them. But there was a very confusing thing. On the opening kickoff last week, the opening kickoff hit the goalpost. It's a live ball. The other team recovers. The main team recovers on the five of the Pirates. Later in the game, they go for a field goal. The Mammoth do, the main team. It hits the upright again. The Pirate got it. It was a 50-yard scramble. You could hear, the guy ran probably about 170 yards to go 50 yards down the field, and you could hear the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do music, and everybody thought it was a safety. And then the ref comes. It's like, no, it's a dead ball when it hits the uprights. And everybody's like, wait a minute, it hit the uprights earlier. And I looked to the broadcast guy to my right. I said, it doesn't say in the rule book that an elephant can't pitch. And four people looked at me like, oh, that's awesome. Right. Because everybody got
There's
that reference.
There's nothing in the rule book that says an elephant can't pitch.
But there is something in the rule book that says it's now time for our random video game review of the week. And make this enjoyable, Joe, because this is the second to last time you get to pick the game with this fucking cast coming up.
Oh, man, that means I got to stretch my calves.
Hey, be lucky. You can stretch your calves. Mine's in a cast. You brute.
Oh, yeah, your calves are like veals.
Yeah, exactly. Ooh. Oh, he doesn't say that in a sexual way. He says that in the cannibal way, just to be really clear. I'm having that feeling like, and again, in a Bugs Bunny cartoon, we're in the little rowboat, and he's looking at me as a Vienna sausage right now.
And what a sausage. Okay, I'm going to wave my hand over my video games, make pressure luck noises, and then Jacques's going to say stop, and I'm going to grab a game. And it's not just Nintendo games. It's anything!
Ooh.
Ready?
I'm ready. Wow, a lot of pressure, hon. Okay, big money, big money. No whammies, no whammies, and stop! Oh, this is big. Ooh.
All right, I looked at nothing, but now I see that I think I pulled a game out of my ass. No, I pulled a game off of my PlayStation 2 video game shelf. And, of course, I have all of my games alphabetized and my feathers numbered for just such a situation. And it looks like there's a lot of glare bouncing off of it, so I can't see so good. I think it's Family Guy game.
It is Family Guy game. Here, nice job.
There we go. Family Guy the video game. I did play this.
That's a
bonus.
That is big.
Big bonus. It's an okay game. The controls are a little sloppy. It's based on the Family Guy, the shocker, based on Family Guy, the TV show. But, of course, it's produced by Seth MacFarlane, and it's voiced by all of the original cast members. It came out 2006. I guess you play a bunch of like different kind of mini games, and I think they're all kind of tied together. But sometimes you play as Peter, and you have to sneak around, like doing something goofy that's kind of ribald. It is rated M, so there is like mature humor in here.
Is Quagmire in it?
Quagmire is in it. He's on the back's cover, actually, on the second frame there. Right there he is.
Voiced and scripted by members of the real Family Guy TV show.
Yeah, and it's pretty I mean, it's okay. It's
That's 2006. Is that before the show came back on?
No, it's because it went off the air in 2002, and then no. When did it go off the air? 2001, I think it went off the air, and then the 9/11 thing with Seth MacFarlane happened. Check out that story if you don't know anything about it. And then it came back, I think, in 2005, like right before. But the DVDs were what spurred the comeback, if you know that story. They were selling, though, like gangbusters. This is, you know, pre-streaming. You know what's funny? When we talk about technology, there's a lot of, this was before. Like, there's a lot of that. Like, this is before.
We're old. In my day.
And there are
back
wolves.
Back in my day.
Back in my day, you had to watch programs on DVDs. Now, DVD stands for digital video disc. A disc is a circular object that you would insert into a player that you would attach to your television. And it would show moving pictures. But the Family Guy video game, it's okay. I guess you play it more for like the fan factor. You know, there's a lot of fan service in this game. It's not as good as like the new South Park games. Like the South Park games, this is a little slapped together. You know, it's not terrible. But the new South Park games are like epic. Like they're like fucking, you know, 20-hour episodes in a video game. Like that's
right.
You know, like those are games you gotta, you know, if you're a fan of South Park, play those games. And I'd rather review the South Park game than the Family Guy video game, but it's okay. So enough about that. What do you want to? Oh, how much does it go for on eBay? You know, the thing about these PlayStation 2 games is that most of them come, they're not hard to find inside the cases because they just come in DVD jewel cases or, you know, whatever the hell they call it. But mine has the manual. A color manual. And video games don't come with manuals nowadays. You know, they're rare. Very rarely do they come with manuals.
No, they do not come with manuals. But the bigger games come with encyclopedia walkthroughs that only cost about $20.
Yeah, exactly. That's how they get you. So I'm going to say that it goes for an eBay, I don't know, $5. Yeah, $6.95. Not bad.
If you could, why don't you hold that up so I can...
You're going to post this on our fucking Instagram, you piece of shit.
If I can figure out how.
Right.
That's a possibility.
Send it to one of your millennials. No, don't. They don't know how to do it either. Apparently, you surround yourself with the dumbest millennials. And then,
seriously.
What's going on? They're just jocks, man.
Yeah, exactly. No, but it was a funny moment when I had to have that explanation. Let's see. I don't want. Oh.
What?
We're going to circle back just for a second. I'm just going to say it once and leave it.
I'm going to turn this podcast around.
Mission accomplished. We didn't talk about that.
Mission accomplished.
How'd that work out for the last president who said that?
At least the last president did it with flair.
He really did. He really did. Put on the flight. He did the whole kit and caboodle with what movie am I thinking? Top Gun.
Yes.
He did the whole Top Gun.
Right. I think Henny Loggins introed him. Like, that's how
he probably did.
Yeah.
You know, how'd that work out though?
You know who introed the tweet?
I do not.
Messina.
But the great thing is, it's like, granted,
this is it.
No, make no mistake where you are.
This is it.
You're back. Oh,
go on.
But it's like, it's one of those things where you know that's a punchline now, right? You know you just went out of your way to write everything for the late night comics for the next 3 days.
Yeah. Although, and then another thing that I was just reminded of is I don't know the validity of this source, but I think 5 hours or 10 hours before the attack on Syria, somebody on Fox News apparently said or suggested that maybe Trump would attack Syria to distract the news cycle from the Stormy Daniels stuff and and the Mueller stuff and
the Comey stuff.
The Comey stuff.
He's making the rounds this weekend.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I don't know, but that's a little too conspiracy theory for me. I mean, this only because it wasn't a unilateral decision; it was like a three country thing. It's not like he called. It's not like he booty called. The United Kingdom and France.
Right,
and said,
right.
Hey,
he did get a couple people on board. One of which you can't really say Theresa May and him are chums. You know, so it was a coalition of the willing.
I know, right. And even Angela Merkel from Germany said that this was an appropriate response considering the circumstances. So, whatevs.
Right. So moving. But yeah, I just looked down at my notes and I saw that I had, because that had happened afterwards. The whole thing.
Do we want to talk about the Apu thing real quick?
Yeah. Could we really? I
just
mean, no. But the whole thing about the 90s sitcoms and what we talked about with Patton.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, if you don't know. There was a documentary that came out by an Indian American comedian and filmmaker who made a documentary called "The Problem with Apu," and it was about unfair representations of Indians in pop culture. And Apu being the main star of this, Apu is of course the Indian character on The Simpsons who runs the Quickie Mart. Voiced by Hank Azaria, not an Indian, and how, you know, there was so little representation of Indians back in the 90s on television in American culture that it was just really unfortunate that this is what America sort of glommed onto as sort of the idea of the typical Indian person in America, and how it was, you know, it's painted as sort of a stereotype and it's not very flattering, and... You know, it got a lot of flack, and actually, The Simpsons had responded, sort of giving some side eye to it this past episode, where Lisa mentions something about how things that were applauded and not inappropriate are now politically incorrect. But what can you do? And then she looks at a picture of a poo on her nightstand, and it's kind of a backhanded. Yeah, we know what's going on. We hear you, but sorry, not sorry, kind of thing. It was sort of a very pale response.
Well, okay, we like the show The Goldbergs. You like the show The Goldbergs.
Yes.
Let's say my two guys, the 10-year-old and now almost 8 in a couple weeks, 20 years from now, they're doing a comedy show based on
the 2010s
on them growing up.
Yeah.
What is their grandmother, who they live with, character going to be portrayed? How would you portray my mother-in-law in a sitcom form?
Oh, right.
Right, because you know, my mother-in-law, you know, former North – she you know, was a refugee from North Korea to South Korea as a child, like 5, 6 years old, immigrated to the United States in her mid-20s. And her accent – she learned English from my wife's father – who had a Goodwill Hunting accent. So she talks with the broken Asian accent with the Bostonian flair to it. And it's funny. I mean, there's so many funny stories. You know, years ago, you know, my wife was a kid and her mom worked at a restaurant and somebody ordered a piece of pie. And some guy ordered a piece of pie, which she asked if he wanted to fuck with that. And when he said, what? She repeated it 2 times. And her father was there crying, like couldn't stop crying, like laughing, and brushed it through the door, you know, was telling, you know, the kids that. It's like, oh, this is what happened to your mom. And her mom was embarrassed and stuff with that. But that's how her mother talks. My mother-in-law, and from what I found from my experience now being in a world with a lot of, you know, Korean-Americans or Koreans who are living in America, you know, they're, you know, not descendants like my wife. There's a lot of similarities. Very often, they're pluralized to single and singleized to plural. You guys want a soda. You know, it's like this one person there, she's asking, you guys want a soda. Yeah, anyway, so stuff like that. Is that wrong to, if I wrote a character, and I'm not making fun of her or the accent, but it's like, how would you portray that without somebody saying, and what's her face? The Korean comedian, Margaret Cho. Like, was she a bad person because her grandmother on her show had an accent?
I guess it's all about perspective and consider the source. You know, the funny thing about the Apu genesis was that it was written as a benign character. It was a non-denominational character. It had one line where Homer goes into a convenience store, the Quickie Mart, and it's not described who the cashier is and who runs the store. And the cashier says, thank you, come again. Hank Azaria during
the—
Hank Azaria took the table read. And out of nowhere, surprising everybody, he went, thank you, come again. And everybody, every white guy in the room died laughing because it was like perfect. Like, oh my God, yeah, of course he's an Indian guy that runs a Quickie Mart. And so they wrote the character to be an Indian guy based on apparently Hank Azaria's interpretation of the line. And of course, if you watch The Simpsons, the Apu's character is not one of the dumber characters in the show. You know, he is a smarter character. He's probably one of the more well-rounded characters. He's fleshed out. He's been given, you know, backstory and a family. But again, white guy speaking here. It's not my— honestly, if it offends people, I'm not the one that's offended, and I can't speak to it. I can see why kids growing up being called a poo because they're Indian. And this guy, you know, the person who made the problem with the poo was, you know, a victim of that. And I could see how that will— – that sort of idea, like, okay, that if that's considered to be okay and if it's not challenged to be not okay, then that becomes the norm and that becomes the normal. And that leads to less incentive for a majority white-run show to incorporate or to be more diverse, you know, to— – actually hire Indian writers, actually hire Indian talent or of any other ethnicity. You know, they also make a point to say, like, they dare not— – or if somebody made a point, like, they would never do that with a black guy. Like, they have black characters on The Simpsons, but it was never like, yo, what's up, man? Like, none of that. Like, it was never a stereotypical black guy. There was one of the black guys is Dr. Hibbert. Another black guy is Carl the Cop. You know, like, they're just members of society, and there's more than one of them on The Simpsons. Like,
what?
You know what I mean? If you look at The Simpsons as a whole, most of them are yellow, which of course is light skinned people, and there's only one Indian family, and it's Apu and his family. So I can see that it is a problem that if that isn't addressed now, that you can see how shows could perpetuate that sort of practice going forward. And no, you wouldn't want to do that type of character when writing something today. Does that make what they did back in the 90s bad?
Well, no. 80s or 90s?
90s.
Okay. Apu came into the 90s?
The Simpsons did.
No, The Simpsons were 80.
In 1989, and then Apu came in, like, you know, season 2 or something.
Some reason. I'm sorry.
90s.
But
again, I was there.
But the funny thing is, it's like, you know, on the other hand, there's the comedian I was just telling you about before the show, Russell Peters, who's – I don't know if his parents are from India and he moved here as a child, or if he was born here, his parents are there. But a lot of his comedy is about that and about the accent. And he talks about, like, the whole tech support in India and all this stuff. And he just talked about, like, he, you know, he booked some dates over there and he was excited. But then he's thinking, oh, my God, they might absolutely hate it. And they loved it. And he goes, you know, but he goes, after shows, people would be like, oh, that is so great. Do they really think we talk like that? You know, and it was funny. And he was like, yeah, can you believe that? And, but that's the thing. It's like, OK, so if you're writing and here's the thing, it's. In the early 90s, that was a stereotypical thing, that 7-Elevens and those kind of places generally were, you know, a lot of people. So, you know, on the other hand, if you
– by the way, still is.
Right. But if you write a character – so I mean, if you wrote a sitcom and my mother-in-law spoke, you know, like she born and raised in Iowa, you know, it would do her and the character a disservice.
I think the end to all of this is that it just calls to – it just brings out to light how a lot of these shows portray characters of different ethnicities by white people. This is the right. White person's version of an Indian. This is not like, okay, that's great. Fine. You know, there. And I was actually talking about this sort of practice of, like, you know, cross-gender playing and cross-ethnicity playing on television with my wife. My wife, another accent. Anyway, the show Baskets, it's on FX. It stars Zach Galifianakis and Louis Anderson. Louis Anderson plays a woman, not a guy dressed as a woman. His character is a woman, and he just puts on a wig and an affect, and he's a woman. And my wife didn't know about the show, and I said, do you have a problem with that? And she's like, yeah. And I'm like, okay, why? It's like, well, because... it tells producers that if the show's a hit, then that tells the producer of the next comedy, this is what sells. This is what pulls in ratings. And yes and no. You know, Louis Anderson is a guy with a history. You know, it's also a unique collaboration, Zach Galifianakis. And I'm not too familiar with all of the writing history. But, like, you know, if you have a talent like Louis Anderson and he's comfortable portraying a woman – and they're comfortable writing for women, and who knows, they might have female writers. They probably have female writers on the show. If everybody's okay with it, then is that okay as well? Like, we're in a fuzzy area where I think it's because of the lack of diversity. If there was no, this is sort of the utopian view, but I think once entertainment becomes so homogenized, the entertainment industry and the production of television shows and movies, once there's a level playing field, and God knows how long that's going to take, but once you start introducing a more diverse crew to all these productions, then it becomes less of a big deal. You know, then it becomes no big deal, because it's fine, because we have, you know, people of all ethnicities writing for this show, producing this show, working as crew on the show, acting on the show. It's all kind of a mixed bag. It's like, you know, the Hamilton of, you know, of television. And then if that's the – once you get that sort of level playing field, then you could probably be more comfortable doing all of these other interpretations of people of different ethnicities and different genders. But because we're right now seeing a lot of television written through the prism of, you know, the man, essentially, it does come off as sort of like, oh, you know, like, this is what white guys think women talk like. This is what white guys think black people do. You know, like, this is sort of like, you know, it's kind of like when Norman Lear would write for fucking Sanford and Son. Like, you know, a bunch
Norman
of Jewish
Lear
writers.
Was Sanford
and Son. A bunch of Jewish writers. Although there is a funny thing that Gilbert Gottfried tells about how Red Fox didn't want to have...
Can a man relax?
I guess Red Fox, apparently, he fired all of his Jewish writers and wanted to bring on black writers or something. And I guess the material wasn't up to snuff. And supposedly, this is what happened. He goes to... he says to somebody one day, bring me back my Jews! Because they had better writing.
Right.
But
fun fact, they took those scripts and they used them for the spinoff of Grady.
Yes! And which we'll close on tonight. with the Grady theme song. Because I did see, like, based on what, yeah.
I watched the opening.
Yes.
Like that minute montage of taking the bus across L.A.
Yes, exactly.
But almost missing every bus.
Oh, that was a close one.
One thing I know about black guys in the 70s, always late for buses. And it was encapsulated by Grady almost missing every bus. So the look Joe's giving at me now is the look
he the Rosa Parks of running for buses? I don't understand what you're going with this. But okay, so again, two white guys' perspectives on how woke we are and how I understand, at least, like, yes, people are offended by whatever they're offended by. And that's fine. And it's good for that conversation to be had. It's not good to go back and retroactively admonish a series for something. If you want to go back and retroactively admonish a series because of today's standards, do that with The Cosby Show. Like, you cannot watch The Cosby Show. I dare you to go into a Best Buy and try to buy a Cosby DVD set. They don't have them in the stores. But like, yeah, if you were to go back and watch Friends, if you go back, I mean, but I was telling Jacques before the show that Bill Maher this week had a closing segment about people going into old television shows, you know, particularly The Simpsons and Apu, and assigning modern day morals to, you know, shows that were written 20, 30 years ago. And he basically summed it up by saying, you know, if you do that, you're a douchebag. And just think about all the shit that we're doing now that your children are going to go look back 25 years from now and go, what the fuck were they thinking? Right. You know, like, what we think we're cool with now is going to be so blatantly like, oh my God, that is so obviously this. They were so obviously racist, homophobic, whatever, you know, misogynistic.
Guilty as charged.
Right. So Jacques will never change. Jacques will be the same Jacques 25 years from now.
God willing.
So anyways,
I'm here in 25 years from now.
I know. We'll be celebrating our 25th anniversary of Carnival Podcast, Carnival Personnel Podcast. Because of our moniker online, I forget that the personnel is part of our name. Anyway, do you want to wrap this up? What's your parenting tip? No, Netflix picks. Hurry.
Quickly, because we didn't get enough video games.
Finally tonight. No.
It's called Man vs. Snake, the story of Nibbler. And Nibbler is a very – it's not a mainstream video game, but it was like it wasn't one of the big ones. It didn't survive. Like when you think of the early 80s video games, doesn't make the top five, probably doesn't make the top 10. But there was a local kid who lived in the town where Twin Galaxy were, and the manufacturer of the Nibbler game, it was the first game that could go up to a billion. Like that was, but you truly took about 36 continuous hours to be able to play it. And there was a big thing where you would get think about this. This is 82, 83. You would get a home game. Like they would bring you the game. Like you would, I mean, how unthinkable is that? You know, and so it was one of the first, Twin Galaxy competitions. And people came from all over to play. And it was funny listening to the story. There was a guy who it was seven or eight tries. And there was two guys who were always making it to the final rounds and always playing. And then things would happen. They would have a power outage like 26 hours in. One guy's hand just cramped up. And there was cut scenes where they would literally put their elbows in ice, drink soda to stay awake.
And they filmed all this?
You know, somewhere it is. But the sad but funny thing is it's like, you know, one of the talking – the two of the big talking heads, it's the guy who did it. This is 35 years later.
The guy who reached the billion point.
The guy who reached the billion. And some of the stories are animated. You know what I mean? And I guess he went home.
It's like Tales from the Tour Bus, but for Nibbler.
So it was funny because it took him literally almost 2 days of continuous play to do it. And he rode his bike home. He's mid-teens. And his parents were like, where were you for 2 days? His mom was like, oh, he laid down. He sat on the foot of the bed. And he said, you know, and mom asked, do you want something to eat? I would like some macaroni and cheese. And then he wakes up and he goes, hey, what happened to my macaroni and cheese? She goes, I made it 2 days ago. He slept for like nearly 2 days. But Billy Mitchell was there when it happened. And he was one of the guys that they were like, a few guys would take him and like dunk him in like cold water in between cutscenes to help, because when he was really close. And then Billy Mitchell, and he, and this documentary is a couple years old now, but it just hit Netflix. And here's a guy who won it, like saying, it's like he was just standing there. It's like, just don't think of get through this screen. Just get through this screen. And how he coached him and he was helping him.
Don't tell me anymore. I have to watch
you,
now.
You, and you are. But it was interesting. But it circles back to the beginning of the show. So here's Billy Mitchell, who's the douchebag of douchebags, but also had these real moments, even in, at the time, because he wasn't going for the Nibbler record, so he could be supportive to somebody else. But it's a good documentary. But we live in a world where there are a number of documentaries, and now, you know, Pixel, Rampage. I mean, that's 79 to 83 window of...
And Ready Player One.
And Ready Player One, which I think we're going to see that tomorrow.
Oh, you mean yesterday. Which,
I'm going to see that tomorrow on yesterday, which you got to come. You got to see it.
Yeah.
That's a must.
If I have a car.
What was it? The Twitter screen grab that I sent you, speaking about, like, you know, Ready Player One, the DeLorean with a DeLorean trailer hitch.
Oh, yeah. There was a trailer hitch to it for DeLorean, and the caption read Back to the Future trailer, which is funny.
But it was a trailer.
It was a DeLorean trailer hitch.
On a DeLorean.
Yeah, it was great.
I don't know how much money that guy has, but kudos.
Not enough to, you know, whatever. But my Netflix pick, I don't know. I think I'm going to change it up because you inspired me. You're talking about Billy Mitchell, heel turned hero, or hero turned heel. Right. Similarly, Andre the Giant, heel or hero turned heel. Do you know who Andre the Giant is?
I will punch you in the neck. if you knew where your wife hit your balls, I would go and kick them.
I just wanted to get that reaction because I'm a heel.
Yeah, the guy. You mean the guy from Princess Bride? Of course, yeah, right. I know who Andre the Giant is.
Right. Great documentary on HBO premiered this week in conjunction with the WWE. Fantastic, Andre the Giant. It's just called Andre the Giant. 90 minutes. They interview Vince McMahon. They interview Hulk Hogan. They interview his Andre the Giant's right hand man, his brother. I don't know if his mother survived. Maybe his sister in France. Fascinating documentary. Moves pretty quickly. It covers basically all the bases, you know, his rise to fame, how he was beloved, how wrestling worked in the 60s and 60s and 70s in America, how it was all regional, and then the WWF came in and nationalized it via Vince McMahon Sr. Vince McMahon Jr., who runs it now, decided to nationalize, and how... There's actually a good portion of it because of WrestleMania 3, where it's Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant. There's a good portion of this documentary that spends about 5 minutes explaining who Hulk Hogan is and how he came to, you know, some people you got to explain who Hulk Hogan is. Mean Gene Okerlund is still around.
Mean Gene.
He's still, and he's interviewed for this, and he looks okay.
That is great.
Yeah, I saw, wow, Mean Gene is still fucking alive. And so, yeah, he's interviewed. They talk about funny stuff like how, you know, Andre the Giant would, like, he loved fart humor, and he loved, like, his farts alone would, like, rumble the fucking room. Like, and he loved to do it in elevators and bar rooms, you name it. You know, the amount of drinking he did. This is probably all passé to Jacques because he probably lives and breathes Andre the Giant secretly. But, yeah, like, he would go through, like, a case of wine a night. He would go through 24 beers minimum a night. He was constantly growing. He had acromegaly, something like that. They knew that he had it. He just never sought treatment for it. Like, he literally refused treatment for it. Like, he just did not want to do anything about it, even though he was in constant pain. Apparently, his spine would always hurt. His head would always hurt. Different joints would hurt. I mean, his feet, you name it. They're constantly growing. But then eventually his heart would stop growing. You know, at some point the organs have to stop. And that's kind of what probably did him in. And he also fucking partied hard. Like, by partied hard, I mean, you know, drank himself
to death. Why wouldn't I like him? Why? What, where's the heel part?
Oh, well, in the WWF, he became the bad guy.
Oh, right, right.
Because he was coming up through the ranks. He was apparently, like, he was the face of the WWF or wrestling. And, you know, he was like the Hulk Hogan. And then in the early 80s, when the WWF starts to go national on cable, Hulk Hogan becomes the sort of the new face of the league, of the federation. And Andre the Giant knew that. And he knew that his days were kind of numbered. He knew as he was getting older that he wasn't going to be able to keep things up. And he knew that he loved wrestling so much that he knew that he would, him handing off the baton to Hulk Hogan to become the good guy would be the way to carry on WWF into the next decade. And so that's when he started, that's when he decided to turn bad guy. He teamed up with Bobby the Brain Heenan. He challenged, I know he basically challenged, you know, Hulk Hogan to he had the title and nobody could actually ever defeat Andre the Giant because
he was the giant.
He was the god. And physically he was just a giant. And then, you know, it just tells the story of like how he basically said, you know what, Hulk is going to be the new World Wrestling Federation champion and he's going to be the heir apparent to this sort of, to the throne. And it's wonderful. It's heartbreaking. It's touching, and it's very good. And if you don't have HBO, too bad.
Did you see the Ric Flair documentary?
No, and that's the thing is I don't have ESPN, so I don't see 30 for 30s.
Because it might be on Netflix now, but I think I might have saw it on demand on cable.
Okay.
That's really good. No, I don't have HBO, but I'll find a way to watch because I'm not a big wrestling guy, which is funny because I grew up across the street from Mike Sullivan. That was his jam. Yeah. Like I could name, and I'm not kidding, in the 21 NHL team, I could probably name almost every player on the rosters in the Adams division, but I could name at least 5 or 10 on every other team. Mike could tell you everybody's ringside manager for all, like, I mean, he was ground floor of wrestling was it. Management is another one. Management early days of wrestling was huge in it. So I peripherally knew, but you knew all the big ones and I watched them all. But I love those documentaries. And it's funny that you're listening to you talk about how he realized that. And I'm not kidding when I say this, when we saw the Netflix show Glow, and it was a similar thing where somebody realizes, look, I'll work out better as a bad guy.
Yeah.
And it's like I want to do this.
For the betterment of the league.
For the betterment of the league, for the betterment of my career, for the betterment of the show.
And for the betterment of the people that they work with.
Right. You can't have a hero unless you have a villain.
Right. It's like the show Heroes.
Right.
When everybody became heroes and everybody had superpowers. And when everybody has superpowers,
no one does.
And when everybody's super, no one is. Yeah.
The Incredibles. But
part two coming out in a couple of months.
Only 15 years later, you know.
Another thing.
Because that's it.
Yeah,
but I will. I'll check that out.
I'm going to blow the I'm going to blow the whistle on this podcast because we are running into the 90-minute mark.
Listen, All-Star Tommy has told me he goes on longer walks and gets more exercise the more we ramble. We're not doing this for us.
Okay. Then I'm going to do the random Nintendo Power Magazine review of the week. Hang on tight. Let's end on a higher note.
Yeah. Parenting tip of the week. Don't break your fucking foot before a long week vacation of school.
Oh, boy.
Because they're trapped with you. You're trapped with them. Somebody's getting hit.
And nobody's getting out alive.
You know, and the person who's getting hit is probably the one who can't get up and chase the little bastards down. So I have a long week in front of me. Parenting tip of the week. Severely injure yourself in a more convenient time of the year.
Yes, right. Yeah, that's a good important tip, I guess. It's better than what I got. I don't have anything.
What do you got?
Didn't I just say I got nothing?
You got nothing.
I never have a good parenting tip of the week because I don't think that far ahead in this podcast. Oh, well. Hey, you know, I bring it now. This is what I'm in the now. We're listening to now.
When you're vamping, it's magic.
Uh-oh, it's magic. Anyways, that's enough on us talking out of our assholes. You've been listening to literally my asshole for about 90 minutes because that's what I talk out of when I do this podcast. Jacques is all, that's all Jacques, 100%. Don't leave me out to dry, you motherfucker. You wrap this thing up.
Okay. Well, then lastly, what was the big point that I made? Oh, do not forget.